شريك له أشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم Dear brothers and sisters, distinguished guests, we Ahmadis are often asked, what are the differences between the Ahmadiyya Jama'at and numerous other Muslim communities present on earth in our age? For a person who knows little about Islam, its tenets and history, there is a number of answers to this principal question, all proceeding from one starting point. And this point is our Jama'at is founded by Allah, whereas all others are the work of man. But it is asked, what are the irrefutable proofs of this lofty statement? Again, we may present a number of proofs, producing the revelations and prophecies of the Holy Prophet Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the promised Messiah alaihi wasallam. We may refer to the fulfillment of the earlier prophecies in our age and, most importantly, expound the famous dedication and daily obedience of the members of the Jama'at to the sole will of Allah. This all-encompassing will expressed in the Holy Quran and Ahadith is daily spelled out to us through the blessed divine office of the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, his revelations and commentaries to the vital issues of Islam. We therefore can derive our religious inspiration not only from that of the Muslims of the glorious past of Islam, but also from its not so distant past and present, and inshallah, its magnificent future. Yet for a person who is somewhat familiar with Islam and its history, the main proof of the divine origin of the Ahmadiyya Jama'at may consist of only one clearly evident and therefore undeniable piece of evidence. It is indeed evident that our Jama'at alone is granted the blessing of Khilafat available for every Muslim prepared to recognize the will of Allah and wholeheartedly submit to this divine will. The functioning office of Khilafat restored on earth according to the Quranic promise of Allah and earlier prophecies of the Holy Prophet differentiates Ahmadiyya Jama'at from all other Muslim Jama'ats in a most cardinal way. As for us, the Ahmadis, the Khilafat is beyond a shadow of doubt the main blessing of Allah upon us, the Jama'at otherwise showered with so many divine blessings. It's our Jama'at's most cherished spiritual treasure. Therefore today, when we are once again gathered from all corners of earth to show our unity and our dedication to the blessed cause of Ahmadiyya, it is more than appropriate to deeply ponder upon the meaning, purpose and design of the office of Khilafat. This topic is of course multifaceted and inexhaustible as Islam itself, if only for one matter. The phenomenon of Khilafat has direct bearing on the phenomenon of prophethood, so much so that Khilafat is the greatest proof of the truth of Islam and the most eloquent argument of prophethood present among men. This innate link between the office of Khilafat and the living presence of prophethood on earth was spelled out by none else than the greatest Muslim of all times, the seal of all prophets Muhammad Mustafa wasallam, in his celebrated hadith. It is reported that the Holy Prophet wasallam, has said, prophethood shall remain among you as long as God shall will. He will bring about its end and follow it with Khilafat on the precepts of prophethood for as long as he shall will, and then bring about its end. An unimaginative kingship shall then follow to remain as long as God shall will, and then come to an end. There shall be then a cruel rule which shall remain as long as God shall will and come to an end upon his decree. Then will then emerge Khilafat on the precept of prophethood. The Holy Prophet said no more. From this hadith alone, we could derive dozens of meanings and the most obvious explanation of all trials of Islam between the blessed eras of the Holy Prophet and his Khilafat Rashida and the era of Khilafat in Ahmadiyyat we are witnessing now. We shall further return to this question of the two eras of Khilafat and their connection. But first, let us put the question straight. What was and what is the very need of Khilafat on earth? Why Khilafat is at all necessary? Maybe by trying to answer this direct question, we will come closer to the meaning of Khilafat and better understand our own responsibilities towards this divine institution. In his August answers to many a question on Khilafat, the Khalifa of the time, Khalifat al-Masih IV, Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmad, once again pointed out that the word Khalifa first appears in the Holy Quran in connection with the first known prophet Adam alayhi salam. It says, "And when thy Lord said to the angels, I am about to appoint a vicegerent in the earth, they said, Wilt thou place therein such that will cause disorder in it and shed blood? And we glorify thee with thy praise and extol thy holiness. He answered, I know what you know not. It is in this verse that Allah first speaks about a Khalifa. The meaning of this title in this verse is therefore a deputy or a prophet. The necessity of such a deputy among mankind was humbly questioned by Allah's angels, who from the time of their creation bear witness to the harmony of the universe created by God in perfect unity. Allah taught the angels everything they knew, yet the question they asked makes us to suppose that the mankind, towards the time of Adam's appointment as the first Khalifa, had already shown all signs of disunity and discord. Otherwise, how would the angels know about disorder and bloodshed? Excuse me. This question of theirs makes to understand the main idea behind the Khalifat of Adam and all subsequent prophets preceding the seal of the prophets Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We see that a Khalifa is sent to us to install into the human mind and the human society the paramount idea of existence and unity of God, and to try and bring about the unity of the nation to which it had been sent. The creation of Allah, as we know, is without any blemish. We again and again see around us the perfect creation of the whole of the universe, the constituents of which have no will of their own. It's only man who has the God's gift to will and choose, a gift which makes him the best and sometimes the worst of God's creatures. Therefore, to bring about and sustain religious unity among men is tantamount to establishing within the human society the mirror image of the perfect unity of nature and universe. Even Adam alayhi salam was apparently set to earth to restore unity already destroyed by men in their worldly pursuits. As the Khalifa, he had to constantly remind people of God and through this means build the unity of the righteous. At the same time, Adam, as any other prophet of God, had to deliver the spiritual message of unity exactly as taught by Allah and withstand all attempts to alter it. Therefore, a Khalifa is not only a messenger, but also the guardian of the message. From this first mentioning of the institution of the prophetic Khilafat on earth, we may derive that the most characteristic features of such Khilafat on earth are a perfect submission to the stated will of Allah and a guardianship over the exactness of the message and the unity brought about by the message. Any righteous person is a witness to the existence of God, and a Khalifa is first among the witnesses. Still, there was a long way from the Khilafat of Adam and all successive prophets to the supreme Khilafat of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, inasmuch as their message was not as final, as perfect as the message of Islam. The first prophets could not establish the Khilafat of their devout successors because their message was limited by the will of Allah. They were sent to their respective communities and nations, but theirs was not a universal message, so there was no question of establishing a universal unity which could perfectly bear witness to the oneness and unity of Allah. Such universal message is only the message of Islam. The prophethood of Islam is so powerful and the teaching is so perfect that after the sad demise of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his righteous caliphs had only to closely follow his perfect example in establishing and safeguarding the unity among Muslims. The continuation of Khilafat in Islam as a universal phenomenon was, however, promised to Muslims by Allah himself. In the chapter Al-Nur, Allah says, Allah has promised to those among you who believe and do good works that he will surely make them successors in the earth as he made successors from among those who were before them. That he will surely establish for them their religion, which he has chosen for them. And that he will surely give them in exchange security and peace after fear. They will worship me, and they will not associate anything with me. The whosoever is ungrateful after that, they will be the rebellious. We see from this verse that Allah did not promise the earthly Khilafat to anyone else but Muslims, and He promised it to all the righteous, because they are the honest witnesses not only to the existence of God, but also of His oneness and unity. This verse, in conjunction with the above-cited hadith of the Holy Prophet ﷺ, presents most wonderful prophecy and most full picture of the institution of Khilafat in Islam. First of all, it is clear from this verse that Khilafat is granted on the precepts of prophethood and only on the merit of taqwa, righteousness. Therefore, Khilafat is promised in principle to any Muslim who attains the highest grade of righteousness. But at the same time, Khilafat is a spiritual and not a hereditary office. It is known from the history of religion and Islamic history that Allah bestows His gifts and offices to whomsoever He wishes. For those among the righteous who upon being elected Khalifa may have fear of their own imperfection and unsatisfactory insight into the deeper meaning truths of their religion, Allah promises that He Himself will help them in further establishing their religion on earth. If then their ummah of believers conduct themselves according to the will of Allah and safeguard Islam and safeguard Khalifat by honestly discharging their respective responsibilities, Allah promises them security and peace after fear. But if the unity in obeying Allah's will, which is the main treasure and the main objective of Khilafat, is ruined, those who ruin it are called ungrateful and rebellious. Khilafat is indeed the heavenly means of sustaining the unity of Islam and fostering its spiritual strength. On the earth, Khilafat at the same time is a social proof of existence and truth of God, the unity within it being the main evidence of the truth of the message which binds the Ummah together. From the early history of Islam, we see that the golden age of Khilafat Rashida prospered as long as the Muslim unity and reverence for the divine origin of Khilafat was there. Once the institution of Khilafat and sincere obedience to the Caliph in everything good was put into doubt, the golden era of the first Khilafat Rashida in Islam began nearing its end, as prophesied by the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is known that certain attempts to destroy the Khilafat of Osman radiallahu anhu were made. Abdullah bin Salam, the scholar who embraced Islam at the hands of the Holy Prophet himself, sternly warned the Muslims of the disaster coming upon the rebellious people. The righteous Caliph Osman also spoke prophetic words when the mutineers resolved to kill him, saying, "If you succeed in killing me, you shall never be able to remain united, nor offer your prayers or face the enemy in unity." The end of the first Khilafat Rashida of the Holy Prophet presents to the believers very tragic and at the same time most instructive lessons. It underlines the divine origin of Khilafat in Islam and its utmost necessity in terms of establishing, fostering, and safeguarding the unity among Muslims. After Khilafat in Islam became a hereditary monarchy, only the power of the Islamic message and the example of the Holy Prophet himself drove the world of Islam along the road of progress for some centuries. But as Khilafat, according to the prophecy of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ceased to be the spiritual pillar of Islam and became rather a social and worldly institution, this inertia of the Islamic civilization had eventually exhausted itself, and only the Mahdi and the promised Messiah could restore its glory by the sole will of Allah. Another disaster which befell the Muslims after the end of the first Khilafat Rashida was the emergence of the class of ulama, which in the absence of the rightly and divinely guided caliph of the time, slowly but surely appropriated the blessed teaching of Islam and used it for its own earthly ends. Intolerance, bigotry, fanaticism and ignorance among the Islamic masses became direct repercussions of the rule of the mullahs. They, by a selfish deeds, were most instrumental in bringing the prophesied latter days of Islam nearer and nearer. And the time foretold by the Holy Prophet had finally come. Islamic discord became so appallingly apparent and such darkness descended upon the world of Islam that only the divine hand of Allah could have brought order and harmony into this chaos of disunity. The second era of the Khilafat Rashida had dawned upon the distressed world with the advent of the promised Messiah and Mahdi Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad alayhi salam. This second era of Khilafat Rashida, or the Khilafat of the latter days, will, inshallah, last forever. The Holy Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who prophesied its imminent coming, never said anything about its ever ending. Its divine eternity also becomes clear upon pondering over the whole range of issues surrounding the objectives of the advent of the promised Messiah in Mahdi, who is sent by God to restore Islam to its purity and facilitate the glory till the day of judgment. The promised Messiah himself gave us the glad tidings of eternity of the Khilafat of the Holy Prophet restored through him. In his Al-Wasiyyat he says, "Do not be grieved by that which I have told you, and let you not your heart suffer anxiety, for it's necessary for you to see the Qudrat-i Taniya, the second manifestation of divine power. Its coming is better for you, for it is permanent and will not be cut till the day of judgment. This second manifestation will not happen till after my departure." To further elucidate us on the issue of Khilafat in Ahmadiyyat, he says, "Since it is not possible for a man to live forever, God has planned to keep alive forever up to the last days his messengers who bear a mark of distinction over the rest of his creatures. To this end, he has established the institution of Khilafat so that the world shall never remain without the blessing of prophethood, inshallah." When thinking of Khilafat, we time and again come to the issue of a deep innate connection between the lofty ideas of prophethood and Khilafat as the means to keep prophethood alive among the believers. A righteous caliph is called righteous also because he never speaks on his own behalf, but rather most faithfully follows in the footsteps of the Holy Prophet and his promised Messiah. In doing so, he mirrors in the presence of his ummah the truthfulness of the prophetic caliphs to the world and deed of God they had chosen to carry. The Holy Prophet himself warranted that both eras of the true Khilafat will be built on the precepts of prophethood, and the divine authority of the true caliphs in Ahmadiyyat firmly rests upon the well-known instruction of the Holy Prophet, who is reported to have said, "Follow in my footsteps and the footsteps of the Khulafa'i Rashideen, who were fully guided." To try and sum up the blessing of the Khilafat and Ahmadiyyat as the true Islam, we may say that the Khilafat is granted to us by Allah as a spiritual and at the same time social means of maintaining the presence of prophethood on earth, as well as preserving and fostering the unity of the believers in attaining the ultimate goal of Islam, the establishment of the mirror of Allah's unity on our planet. The true Khilafat is therefore the proof of the righteousness of the Jama'at, as the caliph of the new era is being appointed by God through the Council of the Righteous, which in itself reflects the level of taqwa in the Jama'at. The caliph is the living heart, the very core of the Jama'at's righteousness in the sight of Allah, the example to follow for everyone who, through faithfully following his caliph, follows the true paths of the Holy Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The institution of the Khilafat is twice blessed as it chooses and distinguishes the followers of the true Islam among all other religions and proves beyond any doubt the universality and finality of the message of Islam. No other religion is blessed with Khilafat on the precepts of prophethood, as the only unlimited and everlasting prophethood is that of the Holy Prophet of Islam, who in himself confirms the truths of all other prophets of God. Here we naturally come to the question of our own responsibilities towards the Khilafat and the Caliph. These responsibilities flow out of the understanding of the true meaning and significance of the institution of Khilafat, as well as from our Muslim obedience to the will of Allah manifested in the daily insight of the Caliph. The Caliph is appointed to direct the spiritual striving of the Jama'at on the right path and to manage the good works of the Jama'at. Our submission and obedience to the decrees is therefore dictated by the deep faith of God in its reflection on our submission to the will of God. Such relationship between an Ahmadi and the Caliphate al-Masih is possible only because the true faith is daily manifested in the doings of the Jama'at and proceeds from love and affection of Ahmadis to their Khalifa and the Imam of the age. Effectively, this relationship of love and sonly daughterly obedience is started with the very entrance into the fold of the Jama'at at the hands of the Caliph. Therefore, an Ahmadi has no other vision of Islam on earth except in the frames of the Khilafat in Ahmadiyyat. It's natural, for there is no other way to sincerely fulfill one's duties as a Muslim than through faithful submission to the God-given rules of Islam within the God-given structure of the Khilafat of the promised Messiah, alayhi salam. If an Ahmadi Muslim indeed wants to bring about the unity of mankind in Islam, within the God-given structure of the Khilafat of the Promised Messiah. He is bound to first strengthen and foster the unity within the Jama'at, of which the Caliph is the God-appointed mind and guardian. By entering into the Bayat with the Caliph, we enter into the Bayat with Allah. Therefore, 10 conditions of the Bayat are at the same time our pledge to the Khilafat and Ahmadiyyat, the main of them being the faithful and solemn oath to be faithful to the institution of Khilafat in Islam. The Ahmadi Caliph is the supreme head of the Jama'at. The spiritual bond of obedience pledged to him cannot be matched by any other social or worldly obligation. Furthering our own righteousness is another obligation toward the Khilafat, for no Khilafat can exist without taqwa being the foundation of the community of believers. But the most binding of our duties and responsibilities, in fact, encompassing in itself great many of them, is our obligation to maintain unity in the Jama'at. It is absolutely impossible without the guidance and supervision of the Khalifa, who in his positions knows full well what is going on in his community. In this regard, obedience to Hazur is the only means to maintain unity beyond all possible arguments to which every human being is so naturally prone. Spiritual prosperity of the Jama'at and its progress in bringing about the final victory of Islam is the price for maintaining unity. Solitude in despair and spiritual distress is the wages of discord, which is the gravest of sins in the new era of the Khilafai Rashidin. Anyone who doubts the blessing of Khilafat becomes a spiritual loser, which is so evident in the history of Islam, left alone the history of the Ahmadiyya Jama'at. The progress of Ahmadiyyat under its rightly guided Khulafa is obvious to any unbiased mind. May inshallah this progress deepen and broaden so much as to embrace in the not so distant future the entire world. Within the Ahmadiyya Khilafat, we are daily blessed with a profound vision, deep spiritual insight, fatherly encouragement, and personal example of our Khalifa. It is our duty to him to obey his word, our privileges that many he may ask us to present our thoughts and advice, which may or may not be accepted by him in his divinely inspired wisdom. If he accepts it, it's a blessing in itself. If not, it's our duty to accept the finality of his decision. Having a unique opportunity and privilege to see our Hazur and speak to him during the granted mulaqats, we must not, however, overburden him with the petty things and our own family matters, if we can resolve them ourselves, which is more frequently the case. Our duty is not only to love, but also to care for the Khalifatul Masih, who cares for the entire Jama'at. By doing this service to the Caliph, one eventually does it for the whole of the Jama'at. In my humble vision, the truest, if metaphorical, picture of the spiritual structure and breakdown of responsibilities within the Blessed Khilafat in Ahmadiyyat is presented by a congregational prayer laid by Hazur. As we follow him in our prayer for the good of mankind and the universal victory of Islam, we remember that he himself in his prayer follows the prayers of the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, following the prayers of the Holy Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the blessing for the entire universe. Thus the whole universe in its unity submits in sincere prayer to Allah behind the seal of all prophets. May therefore our deeds and our sincerity be worthy of the Islam of the age. It is only through loving spiritual obedience to him, through sincerely following him in our salat, in our works, can we hope to be worthy of the message of the Holy Prophet and the blessing of his Khilafat Rashida, which is here to stand, prosper further till the end of days, inshallah.